see my staff members up there tracking so hard. Y'all, I'm happy to be here. I used to come there. I got to say this. My mom and her sister, my aunt, her other sister, my aunt, and their mother, my grandmother, all proud graduates of Winthrop. We call her Grand Best, graduated, as she would say, in all nine. This is a great institution. And just driving around, we had a few minutes before we came in. There's a lot of buildings going up here. And I remember back in the days that we were really struggling in a lot of places in the state. And one of them was here. One of the ideas that came along was to make Main Street into a mall. Y'all remember that? Well, I don't know how long it stayed that way, but it's not that way anymore, of course. But it is really beautiful. And even the backs of the buildings look good, which is something new. The same thing's happening in Columbia. If you've been to Greenville lately, Greenville is not the same place it was 25, 30 years ago. It's booming. And I see it going on all across the state. Charleston, you can hardly get a reservation in Charleston anymore. 47 people a day moving in to Charleston. That's remarkable. I don't know where we're going to put them on, but we are growing. We've been discovered since we've got the interstate highways and air conditioning. Not long ago, I was in Cleveland, Ohio. I'll tell you all about that, because Cleveland's shrinking. I got off the plane and went to the Republican convention, but I'm a Republican, so I went to the Republican convention. And I asked the man when we got off the plane, there were a lot of empty storefronts on Main Street or the big streets in Cleveland, which is was a magnificent city. Great, big, gorgeous buildings, lovely architecture. There wasn't a thing I saw that I thought would tear down if I got the chance. Unlike some of the buildings that had gone up in the 70s around our state that are not very pleasing to the eye, I don't think. But Cleveland was just beautiful, but the population of Cleveland has been cut almost in half, maybe more than that, since the late 60s or early 70s. It's gone from something like 800,000 or 900,000 people down to 381,000. Detroit is just about a ghost town. I think they have about a third of the population they used to have. And people are coming to the southeast, and we see it all the time. And that means industry, business is coming to the southeast. So we really have a great opportunity. But back to Cleveland for a minute, on the way to the national convention, I asked my wife, Peggy, I said, Peggy, did you ever in your wildest dreams see your husband, Henry, making a nominating speech for Donald Trump for president of the United States? In your wildest dreams, did you ever see me doing that? She said, Henry, I hate to tell you, I never seen you in any of my wildest dreams. That's the girl. But it's not a dream, seriously, it's not a dream what's happening in this state. And the way I see it, and I think that these men and women that serve in public office and try to watch these things all the time, which is part of our job, is to read and understand what's going on. I got some solace the other day. Warren Buffett says he spends 80% of his day reading. I guess that's why he's a multi-billionaire. He understands what's going on. Well, the rest of us probably can't do that. But trying to keep up and understand what the trends are and where we are headed is a great exercise in South Carolina, because I'll tell you, we're headed right for the top. And the only thing that can hold us down, in my view, is excessive taxes and excessive regulations. And that's the main reason I'm here today, is to encourage you to let us know what the regulations are that are hindering economic growth and how we can change them, how we can eliminate them, what we can do about them, because that can hurt us. Also, high tax. I think our taxes are too high, and I think we need to lower. That's why I oppose the gas tax. There were a couple of reasons. One, because it's another tax. And as Arthur Laffer will tell you, we had him at the Mansion the other day. He had about 75 people to listen to him talk. He's the supply side man. He's recognized all over the world. He's the one that taught Reaganomics to Reagan, and he was teaching it to us the other day at the Mansion. Had a bunch of business folks in there and some academics from the universities, and it was a thrilling thing to listen to, but taxes depress growth, and the higher they are, the more they depress it. At a certain level, as they would say, a sweet spot, can get up to a certain place, but once to handle the things that need to be handled by the government. But once you go beyond that, you start essentially killing the goose that laid the golden egg, and that's what he demonstrated so clearly. He's written a book called the, what's the name of the book, John? Somebody remember the name of the book? Adam Smith wrote one about the wealth of nations, is about the wealth of states. And it has in there a comparison, a thorough comparison, I recommend it to you, where he takes about 9 or 11 states that had introduced and passed an income tax since 1960. And he compares it with an equal number of states that don't have an income tax. And the difference is just astounding in the economic growth. When you compare it to the economic growth of all the rest of the states, those that don't have the income tax, personal income tax, corporate income tax, are going right straight up. Those that don't are going down. Included in all of them, you know, in that analysis of these places that I just mentioned. And there were a couple of states, I think Michigan, and I don't know what the other was. Dr. Lappas says he doesn't know what they, because it's too late for them to try to reduce the tax burden in order to lift that off the people so that they'll have more money to spend. They'll invest it, they'll create products and things and sell to people, buy them, and the economy goes up. Says it's too late for them to do that. He suggested maybe the only thing left is some sort of a federal bailout of these states. That'd be a horrible thing. But we're not in that situation. He says our taxes need to go down. If we can find a way to get them down and still maintain the services, which I believe we can do, then that's what we ought to do, and I'm looking forward to some tax reform in the next legislative session. But that's what can stop us. Let me go quickly into things that I've seen from where I've been that I think spell great economic prosperity for us. First, of course, is our port. We've got a magnificent port. It's going to 52 feet. We've got the money to do it. The legislature wisely put the money aside, $300 million in case the federal government would not have it. This was 3 or 4 years ago. Of course, the federal government does not have it, but we have it set aside. We're ready to go. And we recently got a budget item put in the Corps of Engineers budget. Lindsey Graham was the one that did a lot of work on that besides our entire congressional delegation. We worked with the White House to try to get that done. It got in there. And that means that we'll be able to start dredging in October. And what that means is our port of Charleston will be, along with New York, New Jersey, in about 15 years, will be the two dominant ports on the Atlantic coast. And the way you spell port is not P-O-R-T. The way you spell port is M-O-N-E-Y. Because these companies that are looking to come here, that want to export things, that want to bring things in to use in building, that's what they look for, is a deep water port. And ours will be deep water. We can have boats going in, these big mega ships going in and out at the same time, 24 hours a day. We can bring them in at high tide now, but not at low tide. We'll be able to do it at low tide once we get to the dredging. That's a big deal. On top of that, we've created, as you know, an inland port in Greer, Spartanburg County. BMW was there. BMW is running a new vehicle off the assembly line every 61.7 seconds in Greer, South Carolina. It's their biggest production plant in the world. They're all over the place. That's a great thing. But how do they get them to Charleston? Because they export 70%. By the way, all of their vehicles are sold before they make them. They're in high demand. So how do you get them to Charleston? Well, that train, Norfolk Southern, goes to Charleston, goes right by the plant, and then comes back out. So that means that they can ship those on the train. They don't have to put them on the trucks. The trucks would have to carry them out, and that's 200 miles, and then come back. That's a 400-mile round trip. They don't have to do that. We broke ground in Dillon County about a month ago for another inland port that will be served by CSX. We got competition with the rail lines. The Norfolk Southern and Greer Cross is 85. This one, CSX, crosses 95. It really doesn't get much better than that. And we're the only state in the country that has such a thing. I think Virginia has one inland port that's short and handles coal, and that's about it. Might be off on that, but nobody's got one like we have, much less two like we're gonna have. And that's just to open us up to even more. We export more tires, produce and export more tires and more completed vehicles. That is all the parts put together ready to go in any state in this country, right in South Carolina. What else we have? We have the port, we have three major research institutions, USC, Clemson, and MUSC. They partner with private companies. Usually the private company will provide some money, and they'll set up a lab, and where you'll have these young, bright people working with the researchers and the engineers and the technicians at the company. It's a great, great marriage, and when these folks come in, and I talk to them about their interest in South Carolina, some of them light up with the notion of joining and having a partnership with a major research university. That's one reason the Siemens company, just about a month ago, gave $628 million worth of its high-tech engineering software. It's the top of the line to the University of South Carolina. That's right, I said 600, I think it's 28 million, 628 million. That's a big time. IBM has a data analytics headquarters at the University of South Carolina building on the corner of Assembly and Blossom Street. Those things that I call up at Clemson, and they're off the scale, and they're coming here. They're starting to call us Brain Power USA because of that collaboration between the research universities and these big, big companies that could go anywhere in the world, but they're all coming here. You see them all over the place. Well, what else do we have? Probably the real key to our success now and for the next few years is going to be our magnificent technical college system. No one else in the country has one like it. We started ours in 1961. We've had leaders and people thinking about which direction to go and making the right decisions in this state for a long time. And it's all starting to come together now. With these companies seeing what we have here, they come here, they're followed by others, then all these subsidiaries join them, and then the suppliers for the subsidiaries join them, and then you have the research universities inventing things that are off the scale, and that creates all these entrepreneurial activities for people. It's just a wonderful thing. It's a perfect storm of innovation, brain power, and prosperity happening right here in South Carolina. But the technical college system is one that is really key to it all. And we have a mature functioning system, and it has components that have supercharged it. For example, probably the best example, our technical college system, if a company in Germany or China or someplace else wants to build a manufacturing plant here, they can approach our technical college system and say, we want to build a plant. What do? We will send a team to their country, and they stay there 2-3 weeks or more, and they'll look at their plant. They'll understand the machinery, they'll understand the robots, they'll understand what you have to know in order to be able to work on these things, and they will come back here and create a curriculum that will train our people how to do those things they need to do to work that machinery, all at zero cost to the plant or the industry that wants to come in. Nobody else in the country does that. That's one reason all these people are coming here. I was at the opening of a place. Silicon thing they make straws and washers and nipples and all this stuff. But anyway, they had a man from Ontario, Canada, who was there, said, we tried to get them to expand here, but we cannot compete with South Carolina. This was in York County. Said, we can't compete. This is about a year ago with what you have to offer. So one thing that we have to do is convince or spread the news to the mamas and daddies out there and the young people that we got research universities, we got four-year institutions, we got two-year institutions, we got all kind of things. But it is not necessary today to be highly successful and make plenty of money. It's not necessary to have that four-year degree. You don't need it now. Things have changed. The technical college offers associate degrees in hundreds of specialties. And ladies and gentlemen, those specialties pay money. the aircraft maintenance technicians average in South Carolina $65,000 right now. We had young people getting out of technical college with an associate degree that are buying houses at 22 and 23 years old. There's one story about a young fellow who was way down on his luck and doing nothing but wandering around. Somebody took him under their wing and convinced him to get his GED, which he did, which allowed him to enter one of the technical schools where the tuition is very low. You don't end up with all this college debt if you go there. And remember, you get that 2-year associate degree, you can go to work right then, and you can go to the 4-year school, you can finish that degree later if you want to, on your own time, and you can do a lot of it on the internet, you know, long distance learning. But anyway, this young man, so he got his welding degree, and he went to work welding, and then he came back and got his nuclear welding degree, and he went back to work, and after a nuclear welding certificate, and after a period, the whole thing about 3.5 years, he was making somewhere between $100,000 and $125,000 with a nuclear welding. And right now, we have 60,000 unfilled jobs out there for skilled carpenters, skilled electricians, welders, nuclear welders, all those sorts of things. And we have a program where we're trying to spread that news to the public out there to let them know that, to get that training. We have apprenticeship programs. Ours are better than most in the country, and they get them developed. But this technical college education, this is higher education. It's highly skilled. It's invaluable. And those jobs have changed so that there used to be, when I was coming along, used to be some sort of a stigma about going to what was considered not a 4-year liberal arts college, and that you must have a college degree to be successful. A 4-year degree, those times have changed. These jobs now in these big plants, I've been to a lot of them in the last 3 years. You don't see toolboxes anymore. All you see is people carrying or laptop computers and those kind of things. And they're not getting dirty. And they're skilled, and they're working on multi-million-dollar machines and robots and all those sorts. It's a different thing. So we have a little bit of a cultural problem where we have to explain that in order to provide the workforce. We have 60,000 short. And of course, as BMW says, it's their job to see that they can train the people when they come in. They see that as their job. But they also understand that our technical college system gives them an enormous head start on bringing those people in. And I guess the final thing I'll say about what we have that other states don't have is that we have a right to work law. That's very important. And like that, we have a right to work attitude. Very important. But the main thing, as stated by the chairman of BMW, when BMW announced a $900 million expansion about a month ago on the 25th anniversary in Spartanburg County, followed by a bigger announcement with less fanfare of $1 billion that will be put in the existing facility. The chairman said, and I quote, he said, "I have been over the world. With my company, BMW, I've been in most of the states of the United States, and I can say we're here because South Carolina is a handshake state. That is, when someone gives you their word that they will work, they will be on time, they will take pride in their work," I said, "you can count on it." I said, "the people of South Carolina are resilient, they're friendly, they're smart, they work, they're dedicated, they're loyal." He said, "that's why we're in South Carolina. That's why we're expanding in South Carolina, and that's why we're not going to leave South Carolina." So those are the sorts of things that we have. Other states have some of those, but no states have all of those. And all of those are the things that are attracting these companies that could go anywhere. And all of those are the things that anyone here who wants to expand or create a business can draw. So it is really good news. And the only way I think that we can mess it up is by overtaxing ourselves or by imposing regulations that strangle businesses. So I issued an executive order a few months ago requiring all of the agencies to go through and see what regulations they have that are outdated or that are not useful or even counterproductive. And we getting some feedback, but we realize that the main feedback, the most competent feedback, would be from those people who are trying to get their businesses running and are running into these regulations that some of us don't even know exist. So that's why we're looking for answers, looking for input, looking for ideas. I think that public office is essentially a hunt for new ideas, for the best ideas, a better idea. And so that's what we're looking for. And we'd love to have you help. And let me finish with a quote Christy Todd Whitman, who was the governor of New Jersey for 8 years and then went with President Bush as head of the EPA, I think, for 3. I was attending a conference of some kind in Columbia in the Capital City Club, which is at the top of what used to be the AT&T building. I'm not sure what it is now. The name's changed. But we were way up there. We had these big picture windows where you can look out all over the horizon. And it's beautiful. You can look down, you can see where the Broad River and the Saluda River merge to form the Great Congaree, and it goes by, and all the grass and the trees and the heavy forests that all the explorers used to write back about their sovereigns when they were exploring this land and saying it's the greatest they'd ever seen. You can see all that, see the State House down there and the grounds, and it's beautiful. And then look beyond that, see the horseshoe to the university, 1801, you remember all the stories. Just beautiful in the horizon. Anyway, we were talking briefly about these assets that South Carolina has, and she says, yes, you do have it all. I just hope you don't mess it up. So that's where we are right now. This is 2017. The states are competing. As Arthur Laffer told us the other day, said this is the only place in the world where you have 50 independent sovereigns that can pass the laws that they want to within the constitutional limits, to try to get the jump or get the advantage on the others. He said this is a wild, fierce, productive competition that's going on in the United States, unlike anywhere else in the world. So what we need to do is make sure that we maintain our competitive edge. We're ahead of these states now. What we need to do is be sure we don't mess it up. And that means we have to use our heads and have some understanding of where we're going. So we need your help. If you know of something, this is a serious request. If you know of something that's hurting business, let us know about it. Call somebody in the office, or any regulation, or let us know, and we'll get to work on it. So that's my story, and I'm sticking to it. I'll be glad to answer any questions. Yes, ma'am.
I beg to differ about what you said, that the 2-year technical thing can transfer. My granddaughter finished the legal aid, tried to transfer to USC. They would not accept your tax credit.
They might not take it. All of them are not the same. I know in Midlands Tech, I think they will take the 2-year associate degree at USC from Midlands Tech. Some of the others don't have that same record.
And the other comment I have 2 grandchildren living in Washington State, and their dad keeps that as his home of record because he's been in Germany because of no state income tax. But the cost of buying a 3-bedroom home is twice what it is in South Carolina.
I'm not surprised a bit at that.
And as far as the taxes, our roads are going to the dogs. South Carolina used to be known for good highways, and all those trucks coming from that port are ruining it. And you have to have taxes to keep your infrastructure.
That is correct. The reason I vetoed that tax increase, which we think is the largest tax increase in South Carolina history, besides the comments that Mr. Laffer would make on such a thing, is the fact that had all the money that was coming from that tax been used for the roads over the years, instead of about somewhere between 30 and 45% going to other things, we wouldn't have had to raise that tax. Okay. Yes?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
I'm Vance Stein, the vice chair of the York County Economic Development Board, and we have a major concern about the industrial property taxes, which are the highest in the nation right now. And then the flip side of that is we have the lowest personal property homeowner taxes due to the Act 388, which is that imbalance between the commercial and residential keeps getting greater and greater. And so, you know, we just want to, I'm glad that you are for tax reform. That's a good thing. And then another suggestion would be if we eliminated all of the sales tax loopholes that we have, we could maybe reduce the overall sales tax. So that's just.
Correct. I'm glad you brought that up. I remember seeing some figures over the years. If we eliminated the loopholes or the exemptions of the sales tax, and a lot of them, the amount of money that comes in from the sales tax itself would double. Again, I think all of those things ought to be on under consideration for coming up with the best plan. But in my mind, the best plan is to lower the taxes. The better. I wish we could get the federal to do such a thing. We know of the enormous waste that we have left, but all of those things, and I'm sure these members of the General Assembly are listening to what you say, and I know they've been considering themselves. So I think we're going to make some progress next year. I think we have to make some progress or we will lose the competitive advantage that we have. If we lose the competitive advantage that we have to other states, then shame on us, because we have it now. We need to hold on to it and increase it and sharpen that competitive edge. Yes, sir. Rick Lee.
Governor, thank you for joining us.
Yes, sir.
Very informative. This is a topic that's a little bit different. I don't expect you've heard this before. Having to do with our public schools, and in particular, the costs that the school districts are being forced to incur as a result of interpretations of standards by the fire marshal and others dealing with stormwater and other regulatory bodies. When we put a school up in the center of the city and at some point down the road decide to expand it or renovate it or make changes in the makeup of the academic activities on that property, we're forced today to put in internal road networks of fire lanes, offloading requirements for students that are far in excess of what the school has demonstrated a need for during its previous 50 years of operation. And the result is that when we're fortunate enough to find a piece of property adjacent to an inner city school that we can add to the holdings, instead of being able to add playgrounds or add proper parking for teachers and other such things, we have to build these serpentine road networks that cost hundreds of thousands of dollars to build and building standards attached to them, which far exceed the requirements necessary to meet the traffic that is going through there. And instead of being able to put money in classrooms or instead of being able to put money in the education for the kids, we wind up doing that, and it's driven by regulatory requirements that we don't have any impact on, we can't deal with. And I would just like to encourage you to set up some sort of organization or committee to look into these things, to work with the fire marshal and the stormwater people and so forth, because the inner city schools are not the same as just buying a bunch of farmland out of the county. The inner city schools have unique needs, and if we want to keep schools where people live, we have to find ways to do these renovations and modernizations more economically. So that's my pontification on that.
That's a good one. In fact, the remedy and answer to that is so easy, I'll have some of the family stand up for you to answer.
Done. So moved.
Yeah. That's the kind of thing we're looking for, by the way. By the way, seeing you here reminds me, y'all know we had a Scanlon and Sandy Cooper decided not to move forward with the new reactors, which is a real problem for the state. And Senator Fanning and I talked about this recently. But we started working with Sandy, with Scanlon and Sandy Cooper several months ago when these problems were becoming becoming very apparent to everyone. And we almost succeeded in getting a tax credit passed in Washington, and I thought we have to get it through the Senate, and we have to make the renewed efforts to do that. We went to work, and the administration communicated their desires that Toshiba live up to its guarantee, and it looks like Toshiba will live up to that $2.2 million guarantee that they had issued on behalf of Westinghouse. They say they will. Whether they will or not, of course, we don't know. But we've determined that the best way out of this to try to make something positive out of what is a very big negative right now for the nuclear renaissance that was going on in the country. And we've got fewer and fewer people that even know how to work on a nuclear plant. And that's part of the problem we have. We've got two here, and two in Georgia, and that Martin facility down in Aiken. That's it. Right now, so I don't want to let those go, and I believe that the energy needs of this part of the country are going to increase because, as I say, everybody's coming here for all the reasons I stated. But we have proposed that we sell Santico, which has an asset value of about $10.5 billion. It has debts of about $8 billion, maybe a little bit more than that. As you know, Santee Cooper owns 45% of the two nuclear reactors under construction at the B.C. Summer Place and owns one-third of the one that's functioning now. Well, we've got a lot of that. We have seven functioning nuclear reactors in South Carolina. They put off absolutely zero carbon. And once you get them built, which takes some money, the cost of the power is steady and low. Doesn't depend on the market. But we're trying to find a way to see that one, maybe both, if one of those reactors is built, or perhaps some other kind of energy can come in. We're getting calls from a lot of interested people. Most everybody asks for confidentiality at this point. A little bit of it's been in the newspaper. But we've had a number of meetings, many telephone calls, and we're working on it because we don't want all that money just to have gone into the concrete in the ground. You know, the one Duke was started on over in Cherokee County was the one that was abandoned, is that right? And was used in the movie The Abyss. Anybody see that? It went way down. That was filmed. They filled it up with water. And that's one thing you can do. That's not what we had planned. But a lot of complications, but that's a big, big company. Calling and inquiring, and we are trying to find a way, as I say, to continue on one or both, or we'll sell Santee Cooper. Santee Cooper has about 173,000 customers. The co-ops have 750,000 customers. Scanner has something less than 750,000. But we've got a nice package that we think we can work out to maybe even make a big positive out of this. Maybe, emphasize on maybe. There will be hearings and discussions to find out exactly what happened and who knew what and when and were mistakes made. And if not, when something like Westinghouse goes bankrupt, that's not the kind of thing you expect, of course. But it's a very interesting situation, but we'll still have power. We're not going to lose any power. But the question is, how are we going to make this good to where the ratepayers are paying all that money, are not throwing that money away? Is there some way to get a refund to them if the plant don't go forward? There are a lot of questions in there, but I just wanted you to know we've got a lot of brain power working on it from a lot of different angles, and we'll have more to explaining the amounts that are really there. That's an extra added attraction. That wasn't part of it. Yes, sir.
Thank you, Governor. I'm Phil Leeser. I'm from KCI Development, or KCI Technologies here in Mike Hill. I did want to reach out while you're here and tell you that there's a metamorphosis happening with roads today. Counties are really stepping up to the plate and generating their own sales tax to do improvements. And obviously, we've got to partner and work with the South Carolina Department of Transportation because they own most of the roads. What I would like to see as we continue to grow, York County, obviously, the first one that did it, we've got counties, I think, 35, 36 throughout the state of South Carolina, removing their own sales tax. First of all, I'll say the DOT, SCDOT, has been great. Not complaining about them, I'm not talking about roof configuring them, but I do think there's an opportunity to create a partnership between these counties who are doing these projects and bringing this money to the state and the South Carolina Department of Transportation, so we can find a way to streamline these processes, get these roads done a little bit quicker, and almost come up with a new set of standards for these locally funded roadways that can rush these things through. The biggest complaint, I think, that citizens who have agreed to tax themselves to make these improvements, the biggest complaint is how quickly or how slowly things get done. A partnership, a coalition, something that we can maybe meet once a quarter, where these local sales tax initiatives can come down and meet with DOTs and represent there to come up with these new processes to make that a little faster.
But what is it that's the bottleneck?
I think the sheer magnitude of the projects that are coming out now. You know, York County's getting ready to do its fourth. I know there are other counties that are doing their third. All that's having to be reviewed by the DOT. All that's having to go through them and say, hey, look, you're doing it the right way. You're doing it according to the man. You're doing it. All those have to go through that, and there's not enough manpower in DOT. Not advocating more manpower, just some sort of group effort to come up with a way to process that.
Is the road you're building, are they being financed or built solely with that tax, or is the state money coming?
In a lot of cases, solely with the tax. And there are some opportunities that counties use to match monies and get some DOT money, but solely, a majority of it is solely the local money. But it is on DOT system roadways.
I appreciate that.
Yes, sir.
But could you write that down and send that to me, please?
Yes, sir.
Governor, we have time for one more question.
We have time for, how about these two men have to start?
Excuse me, Bill Shannon, New York County Manager. And I've got to respond a little bit to Phil. No pun here, but over the last 4 years, I have seen, I'm the York County Manager, and I have seen a lot of those improvements that Phil was talking about. I agree with Phil. We meet with them monthly and quarterly meetings, talk about DOT. Our processes have gotten quicker, more efficient. We've saved money in certain areas. So is there a way to go? Yes, there is a way to go. But we are better now than we were 4 years ago, and DOT has worked amazingly with us. Over the last 20 years, we're talking $400 million with the roads in New York County. So is it where it needs to be? There's always room for improvement. Is it a lot better now than it was 4 years ago? Yes, yes it is. So, I don't disagree that we can't get better, but I want you to know that we are getting better.
Good. But if this city is any example of progress being made, I'd say there's a lot of progress being made. It really is beautiful. Somebody who doesn't get up here, doesn't live here, doesn't see it every day, it's quite simple. Who is that? Is this? Yes, sir.
My name is Jason Broadwater. Are there any plans being laid or efforts or initiatives to think beyond roads in terms of moving people? Because new products, new information, but our ability to move people, but the new economy is about a lot. So everything from 36% poverty in New York, where we're trying to get people to buy them, all the way to high-speed trains that can take somebody from Charlotte through Columbia down to the port to do business. Are there kind of connectivity strategies and thinking beyond widening and improving roads and concrete, asphalt, or
yes, there is a lot of that's going on at the university. I know a lot of going on at USC, and there have been a lot of conversations at the Department of Transportation about that, and walking, walkable communities and all that sort of thing. So the answer is yes, but right now we've got a lot of roads out there that need to be fixed. There's another question about new roads, at least new big highways. I'm not talking about county roads. But the answer to your question is yes, and I'm sure as time goes on, there'll be more. A lot of new things happen. Y'all, I appreciate the invitation. I enjoyed it. And I hope to see you.